Good afternoon. My name is Harry Attridge, Dean of the Divinity School, and I'm happy to welcome you to this year's third Terry Lecture. As Dale Martin reminded us last week, the Terry Lectures were instituted almost 100 years ago by a bequest from Dwight Harrington Terry of Bridgeport. Their aim is to shed light on religion from the point of view of contemporary science, and this they have done in a magnificent way over the course of the last century. As Dale also noted, the original benefactor hoped that the conversation between religion and science would contribute to the nurturing of the Christian spirit. The terminology may sound a tad quaint, but at the Divinity School, where we spend much of our time and energy on the practice of religion, we still have sympathy for Mr. Terry's aims. It's vitally important, in other words, for theology to be in constructive dialogue with the best scientific thinking, and the Terry Lectures give us an opportunity for that conversation. Our Terry Lecturer this year, as you know, is David Sloan Wilson, professor of evolutionary biology at Binghamton University. He's published extensively in the field with such works as The Natural Selection of Populations and Communities. Particularly important are his contributions to the conversation between evolutionary thought and the study of religion. These include Unto Others, The Evolution and Psychology of Unselfish Behavior, and most importantly, Darwin's Cathedral, Evolution, Religion, and the Nature of Society. That wide-ranging book offers new perspectives on various religious phenomena, from Calvinism in 16th century Geneva to the water temple system of Bali, from Judaism as seen through the eyes of social scientists and novelists such as Isaac Bashevis Singer, to early Christianity seen through the lens of sociologists such as Rodney Stark and historians such as Elaine Pagels. I wish I knew as much about biology as Professor Wilson does about my field. So far in this series of Terry Lectures, we've been introduced to the conceptual framework of multi-level selection theory and has seen it applied to various kinds of entities, from slime molds to water buffaloes, and to entities that we might not think of as social groups, simple biological organisms to ecosystems. Today, we move on to the relevance of this kind of multi-level selection theory to human groups. I, for one, am particularly eager to hear what Professor Wilson will say on the human social organism, how human groups function or fail to function as adaptive units. After the lecture, there will be a question and answer period as usual, and we would ask you to come to the microphones to my left and right to pose your questions. If you have questions that are not able to be posed in this session, you may do so to Professor Wilson via the web at yale.edu/terry/lectures. After the lecture, there'll be a reception across the street, and we look forward to continuing the conversation there. Tonight, I'm happy to welcome you all and to introduce our very special guest, Professor Wilson.
Well, thank you again. Speaking to a transdisciplinary audience is always my favorite kind of audience. And let me begin by summarizing my previous lecture as a way to approach humans. So I began by discussing what I call the fundamental problem of social life, the fact that from an evolutionary perspective, adaptive societies are not nearly as straightforward to explain as adaptive individuals. And the partial solution, as Darwin saw, to the fundamental problem of social life was group selection, that if you want to explain how a society evolves to be adaptive, anything above the level of an individual, then you must postulate and show a process of selection at that level. The rule is adaptation at level X requires a corresponding process of natural selection at that level. And although, aside from Darwin and a few other individuals, this idea was not well appreciated for most of the first half of the 20th century, and many people who thought about evolutionary biology spoke interchangeably about the good of the group, the good of the individual, the good of the species, as if there was no need to distinguish. And all of this came to a head in the 1960s, and the conclusion that appeared to emerge was that group selection was always a weak force in nature, and this ushered in what I call the age of individualism, where everything that evolves was regarded as some kind of self interest, including such apparently altruistic traits as existed in nature. And then finally, what I tried to show is that in more recent times, we're achieving what I call a permanent middle ground, a multi-level selection theory, in which group selection is a significant force in some cases, certainly by not all cases. And so what we need to do is we need to evaluate levels of selection on a case-by-case basis. And I actually have a lot of optimism and confidence about the idea of a permanent middle ground. That might seem naive that anything in science can be permanent, but the fact is that although there's always a zone of controversy, a frontier of controversy, there are some things which do get settled. So there will always be evolutionary theory. The importance of competition used to be controversial in evolutionary biology, and now everyone agrees that competition is an important force, not always, and so you have to figure out its importance on a case-by-case basis. And so we're achieving a situation in which we acknowledge that group selection can be important, and then we simply need to know on a case-by-case basis exactly how important it is. Now, surely one of the most exciting parts of this middle ground is this idea of major transitions of life, which appreciates that the balance between levels of selection, the relative importance of within versus between group selection, is not something that's static, but which is something that can itself evolve. There's a co-evolutionary process between traits that alter the balance between levels of selection and traits which evolve on the basis of that alteration. And when you get the evolution of traits that limit selection within groups, that concentrates natural selection at the between group level, and then the group becomes a new organism, a higher-level organism, and the agents that make up that group, the members of the group, take on an organ-like status. And this idea is being applied again and again to the origin of life. The concept of hypercycles is basically the idea of a society of molecular reactions, basically, cooperative molecular reactions. To cell structures such as the chromosome, as I illustrated briefly, is a structure which causes all of the genes to replicate as a unit and therefore prevents differential replications within the cell, to the eukaryotic cell as a symbiotic community of bacteria, to multicellularity, our rules of genetic and development. Leo Buss at Yale University was very influential in establishing some of these ideas, and finally to the idea of social insect colonies as superorganisms, an old idea which is once again becoming very well established. Let me quickly recount two on our ways to studying humans. Every one of you learned about the rule of meiosis in high school. You know that, of course, diploid organisms have two sets of chromosomes and their gametes have just one set. And the rule of meiosis dictates is a fair process whereby each gene has an equal chance, a 50% chance of getting into the haploid gametes. And so what that means is that no evolution takes place within the individual organism. You come in with a certain genetic composition, and then if you were to measure the composition of your gametes, it would be the same as your body. But the rules of meiosis can be broken. There are genes that break the rules of meiosis. And so imagine that you're such a gene, and you have two effects. In the first place, you get into 90% of the gametes rather than 50%, but that's the good news. The bad news is that you decrease the survival of your individual that you're in by, say, 20%. So your individual suffers. But that within-group advantage more than pays for the individual level cost. And so these traits, which they're called meiotic drive, can evolve and do evolve even at the expense of the organism. In this case now, the organism is the group, and the genes are the members of the group. So it's a conflict between levels of selection called intragenomic conflict. Now, why don't we see more of these? And we do see them, so they are out there. Often because other genes evolve which inhibit their expression. And if you were to read the scientific literature on this subject, you might be surprised to see terms such as sheriff genes and outlaw genes and parliaments of genes. It's almost as if the rules of genetics and development, which were originally referred just to regularities, things that happen most of the time, have taken on a new meaning. The other concept of rules is a social contract enforced by punishment. So this is so interesting. Another quick example. So bees have a genetic system called haplodiploidy, whereby if you lay an unfertilized egg, you haven't mated with any males, but you lay an unfertilized egg, that turns into a male. What that means is that worker honeybees who, should be spending most of their time industriously working for the economy of the hive can also lay their own eggs, and that if you were to work through the genetics of this, you'd find out that it would be in their genetic self-interest to do so. A female that did this, such a trait, would evolve. But this behavior is rare because those few individuals that do it are attacked and their eggs are eaten by other workers. And this is called policing, another anthropomorphic term applied to animals. And if you now read the current literature on social insect colonies, you'll discover that the reason that they function as well as they do is not just because of genetic relatedness, that was the prevailing idea in the 1960s, but because of these social control mechanisms, which are called policing behaviors. So against this panoramic background, which I sketched last time, what we want to do today is to ask, can these evolutionary ideas be applied to our own species? Is there some sense that this theory, which is being applied to so many areas for the rest of life, can also be applied to our species? And can they shed light on a specific topic, such as the nature of religion? It's fun to talk in terms of broad generalities. It's even more fun to talk in terms of specifics. The beauty is in the details. And so if we can say something specific about a topic such as the nature of religion, of course, itself a very broad topic in its own right, then wouldn't that be great? And then I have another theme I'd like to develop, which has to do with this idea of integration and what my namesake E.O. Wilson called consilience, the idea of unifying broad bodies of knowledge, which we're certainly trying to do here. And often when you listen to discussions of this sort, you hear about reduction, as if somehow subjects at one level are going to be reduced to some kind of lower level, such as physics or biology being reduced to physics or chemistry. Perhaps you can think of the social sciences being reduced to evolutionary biology. Often you hear talk of replacement, as if large bodies of knowledge are going to become obsolete. And I think that both of these ideas actually confuse the true nature of integration and the kind of transdisciplinarity which has already started, basically, for this subject. And so I want to consider this along with our more specific topic of human sociality and the nature of religion. Well, to get us going, I'm going to preside a one-minute history of the social sciences here. In Darwin's Cathedral, I begin with two chapters. One's called The View from Evolutionary Biology, in which I basically recount what I did in my last lecture, but then another whole chapter on the view from the social sciences, because what's so important to realize is that the concept of human society is like an organism. An organismic metaphor has existed throughout history. Certainly you can go back to Greek thought, and Plato and Socrates were comparing society to an organism. Here's an example from Joseph Butler, the Anglican priest, is that right? Bishop, I think, and philosopher, who says, "It is as manifest that we were made for society and to promote the happiness of it as that we were intended to take care of our own life and health and private good." It was manifestly obvious for Butler that in some sense people exist for the welfare of society. That was something that would be unquestioned. As we move to the social sciences, and of course the social sciences really weren't identified as sciences, it hadn't really differentiated from philosophy until roughly the 100 years ago. This is a wonderful quote from Daniel Wegener, who's a contemporary social psychologist now at Harvard University, who says, "Social commentators once found it very useful to analyze the behavior of groups by the same expedient used in analyzing the behavior of individuals. The group, like the person, was assumed to be sentient, to have a form of mental activity that guides action. Rousseau and Hegel were the early architects of this form of analysis, and it became so widely used in the 19th and early 20th centuries that almost every early social theorist we now recognize as contributor to modern social psychology held a similar view." In other words, you only have to go back 100 years, and it was just common sense to think of societies as human societies as like organisms. Nevertheless, the rejection of this kind of holistic view, organicist view, of human society took place, and there was an age of individualism in the human sciences, just as in the biological sciences, with very little connection between the two. And I think this is something that social historians should really pay attention to. How is it that we have this kind of a sea change between groupish organicist views of society, either animal or human societies, around the middle of the 20th century, with minimal connections in terms of formal theorizing between the two. By 1994, the great recently departed social psychologist Don Campbell could say this: methodological individualism dominates our neighboring field of economics, much of sociology, and all of psychology's excursion into organizational theory. This is the dogma that all human social group processes are to be explained by laws of individual behavior, that groups and social organizations have no ontological reality, that where used, references to organizations, et cetera, are but convenient summaries of individual behavior. And as in science, so also in the rest of life, here's a notorious quote by Margaret Thatcher, who said in 1987, there is no such thing as society. There are individual men and women, and there are families. And so for many people, not all, this primacy, this privileged status of individuals was so great and so dominant, as unquestioned as the idea of people existing for the welfare of society was for Butler. So individualism has become so prevalent that for many people it's difficult to see how intelligent people could ever think otherwise. And so what we have here is what we can call the disunity of the human social sciences. One point to make is that this question, the functional basis of human society, has always been a central issue, always will be a central issue in the study of the human social sciences. So the question that we're asking from an evolutionary perspective is not a new question, not in the least. It is one of the oldest questions that has ever been entertained by people interested in humans from any perspective. And the answer appears to be more a matter of perspective than anything that we can call a scientifically validated result. You might think that it's somehow we can actually prove in some sense that human groups, that human society is not organismic, everything is individualistic. Not at all. And I presented this as a historical trend, but it's worse than that, because in Darwin's Cathedral, I described the human sciences as a vast archipelago of disciplines with minimal communication often between disciplines. So even though in many fields this organicist view of human societies has indeed been rejected and is indeed ridiculed, basically, as thoroughly old-fashioned, you can find many branches of the human social sciences today in which this is the prevailing view. And one of the interesting things about being an island hopper, like intellectual vagabond like me, is you go from field to field to field, it becomes striking that one person's heresy is another person's commonplace. And so the human sciences are disunified. There is no unity, really, much at all. If you review the major theoretical perspectives in the human sciences, a short list might include functionalism and structuralism, which had its day and then was largely rejected in favor of rational choice theory, other forms of what's called methodological individualism. Behaviorism had its day and was rejected by more cognitive versions of psychology. Marxism had its day. And all of these, of course, have not really had their days because, as I said, there's branches of the social sciences in which they're still alive and well. Dozens and dozens of micro theories. If you go into the human sciences where people are really working hardest in a scientific sense, then what you find are really good theories for their particular topics, but no effort really to describe these as general theories. And then if you go from the human sciences to the humanities, a distinction that's interesting to think about, and if you go, for example, to a literary theory a class, it's a point of honor to have 20, 30 theories and never even a hint that we're trying to winnow these theories. A theory is a perspective. And so it's just a very sad situation if you subscribe at all to the ideal of the scientific method in which there's supposed to come to the facts of the matter. And you might think that's naive, but of course that's something to talk about. So these theories, and especially the big ones, are not alternative theories in a scientific sense, either with respect to each other or evolutionary theory. They make broadly overlapping assumptions. And interestingly enough, they all rely on an evolutionary origin story when you press them. So if you were to go, for example, to a behaviorist who thinks that everything can be explained by some very simple domain general rules of learning, and you would say, why are animals like that? And they would have to say, well, the animals like that evolved compared to some animals that were different. If you go to an economist who more or less places all their stock in rational choice theory, the concept of individuals as self-interested utility maximizers, we can explain everything with that one simple principle and say, well, why are people like that? Well, what could they say? But, well, we evolved. Those traits were adaptive, and the other stuff wasn't. So everyone has to tell. If you go to a social constructivist who thinks that human potential and human societies are completely open-ended and more or less anything goes, and we're to ask, why are people like that? And they say, well, that evolved. And so every one of these relies upon an evolutionary story, which for the most part is completely unspecified and certainly not in touch with anything that's been happening in evolutionary biology over the last 30 or 40 years. It's really like an origin myth. That's very interesting for me to think about that, that scientists requiring origin myths in order to explain their theoretical perspectives. And so when we talk about unifying the human social sciences and using evolution to unify the human social sciences, we're really talking about something which many people who have considered this disunity that exists are calling for. And so what we need in the first place is an evolutionary origin story that takes modern evolutionary theory seriously. Our ideas about evolution and our specific knowledge about human evolution are getting sophisticated enough so that we can actually say something more intelligent and refined about how we actually evolved and how we acquired these distinctive human traits. Now, the major elements of this theory is going to have to include elements of previous major tradition. No tradition could ever succeed as a major tradition if it wasn't saying something relevant to humans. And so we're going to have to say something about innateness. We're going to have to depart somehow from a complete blank slate kind of version of human nature. We're going to have to include something important about intentional thought, because clearly much of what we do is governed by intentional thought, even if everything isn't. Clearly, we have open-ended developmental and learning processes. Clearly, we live in a socially constructed world. Our physical environment is socially constructed, and to some extent, our mental environment. To an equal extent, our mental environment is probably socially constructed. And so all of these elements are going to be in our evolutionary theory, and that's what's so important, is to see them as something which don't stand as alternatives to evolutionary theory, but as aspects of humanity which need to be understood from a sophisticated evolutionary perspective. And in this enterprise, everyone is welcome and actually needs to be participating. It's already in progress, and what you will find, and this is why my intellectual life is so much fun, is that I count amongst my colleagues economists, anthropologists, biologists, anthropologists, historians, and scholars of all things human. And one important point to make here is that anyone who studies humans, regardless of the theoretical perspective, but just in terms of having empirical knowledge about anything human, they're the ones that have the empirical information. And this information might be interpreted, reinterpreted, and it might be directed in some new way, but there will be no way that anyone who knows something important empirically about any aspect of humanity is going to become obsolete. And so I want to introduce you to a few of my colleagues. In fact, I want to do this by perhaps suggesting a few your next Terry lecturers. This, I think, should be perhaps your next Terry lecturer. His name is Herbert Gintis. He's a very well-known economist. He and his colleague Sam Bowles made a reputation for themselves as kind of bad boy radical Marxist economists earlier in their career, and he has now become, both of them have become very influential in this enterprise. If you go to his website, easily reached through Google, download a copy of his paper called Toward the Unity of the Behavioral Sciences, And you'll hear more or less the same argument from the perspective of a very, very good and smart economist with a Marxist background. I just downloaded this picture off the web today, and it turns out that Herb is speaking at a conference here. I don't know if you could read it, but it says, "Biology and the Law, the New Account of Human Nature." And this just shows you the many different kinds of conferences that are taking place. Herb has been invited 3 times within the last 6 months to NSF to give this talk, to his talk, to the NSF program officers. And so this is telling you how seriously the scientific community, including the funding community, is taking this idea of the need to unify the human behavioral sciences. Okay, so now I want to spend the rest of my time applying this unified perspective. I need to say something about what we now know about early human evolution, because it's important to say something about the concept of innate human nature. And then I'll spend most of my time talking about the nature of religion, getting down to specifics, including modern religions, because it's very important to show that when we talk about this in an evolutionary sense, we're not just talking about stuff that happened long ago. We're talking about things that are happening in the present day and that can be applied to the dynamics of something like religions or any other human social organization in the present day. Okay, this is your Terry lecturer for 2007. His name is Chris Bohm. He has had a dual career as a cultural anthropologist and a primatologist. And he, among others, have been applying the concept of human evolution as a major transition. So this concept of major transitions to our own species. And he has a wonderful book called Hierarchy in the Forest, also some articles of the basic thesis of this of his work, is that if you look at small-scale human society, the kind of human society which existed prior to the invention of agriculture, it's first and foremost, these groups are first and foremost moral communities. There's a kind of egalitarianism, but it's not the kind that Rousseau imagined, in which everyone is just noble. It's a kind of a guarded egalitarian in which you expect others potentially to cheat and to want to dominate others, but the group has the wherewithal to collectively dominate any would-be dominator. And Chris calls this reverse dominance. And one of the things that happened with our species that made us different than all other primate species, in a typical primate troop, then the strongest individuals are able to dominate the others. They simply take what they want, and this is not a favorable situation for cooperation. And our species, for reasons which are, there are some a number of possibilities, it became possible for the subordinates to collectively dominate any would-be dominator. And so this is a plausible continuity scenario for basically how we could have the kinds of mechanisms which limit selection within groups. So if you look at the traits that we think of that are associated with moral systems, what you think of, if I were to ask you to categorize moral systems as a number of traits, it is remarkable how many of those have the effect of decreasing fitness differences within groups. Basically, what they do is they define rules of right conduct and they enforce them, and what counts as right are more or less traits which are going to cause everyone to benefit within the group, as opposed to some exploiting others within the group. And so what this means is that morality, and this is so simple, but at the same time, I think profound, because throughout the history of evolution, it seemed that evolution was great at explaining selfishness, but that morality had to be explained in some other way. And now it turns out that morality itself is probably at the heart of what it means to be humans. With a moral system in place, then that shifted the balance between levels of selection, made it really hard to succeed by exploiting your neighbor, and made it relatively easy, or at least made it the only possibility, is to succeed by you and your group doing well compared to other groups. Okay? So moral systems can be interpreted as a set of mechanisms that alter, that shift the balance between levels of selection, and that's what it means to be a major transition. This is your Terry lecturer for 2008. Terry Deacon, author of The Symbolic Species, who has a dual career. He's got three or four careers, but mostly as a neurobiologist and as an anthropologist. And the thesis of The Symbolic Species is that humans are nearly unique in their capacity for symbolic thought. Any uniqueness argument like this, you might say, how can this be? How can you make an evolutionary argument for human uniqueness? But he has a very ingenious way for doing this. And to make a long story short, because if we need to explain the two most remarkable things about humans that set us apart from other species, is first of all, our collective nature, the fact that we're so cooperative in groups of non-relatives. So the fact that we seem to exist in corporate groups, that seems to be something that's unique about us that needs explaining. And the other is our capacity for symbolic thought and rapid forms of learning which are preserved by social transmission. Okay, and so what this means is that we have evolutionary processes which are built by genetic evolution, but which are themselves non-genetic. So there's mechanisms of inheritance which are non-genetic. So these are psychological, cultural evolutionary processes built by genetic evolution. And when we think of these, I think it's the immune system is a really nice model for thinking about these other kinds of non-genetic evolutionary processes, because it's the one that we understand the best. So the immune system is elaborately innate. You could never understand the nature of the immune system without appreciating its innate genetic sophistication. And yet what that sophistication enables the body to do is to create new solutions to new problems involving diseases by a process of blind variation and selective retention. And so we have two things. We have a genetically innate component, which we have to appreciate, and then we have a fast-paced, open-ended component that we have to appreciate. And so this is a really nice way to combine the concept of genetic innateness, and that there's some sense in which we have an innate psychology, but this innate psychology enables us to come up with new solutions as individuals. So you can think of an individual as an open-ended evolving system, and you can think of as a culture or as a group as an open-ended evolving system. So this is not going to be your Terry lecture for 2009. He could have been for 1909. Maybe he's the person who Mr. Terry had in mind. Good old Emil Durkheim. And one of the points I'm trying to make here is that how much we are working with the ideas that have been present all along. So if you read Durkheim, here are two of the canonical statements of Durkheim. A religion is a unified system of beliefs and practices relative to sacred things which unite into one single moral community called a church, all those who adhere to them. Or in all of its aspects and at every moment in history, social life is only possible thanks to a vast symbolism. Durkheim, who is still loved by some in some branches of the social sciences but has been rejected in so many others, if you read these two passages from a modern evolutionary perspective, you can see there is much that you can accept. And so we're in a very interesting situation of being able to take these ideas which have been within the social sciences for so long and actually being able to examine them and perhaps validate them in a way that has not been done before. Okay, so this brings us to the specific study of religion from an evolutionary perspective, what one can call a new field of evolutionary religious studies. This is a quote I love in which I ended my last seminar, my last lecture with. It's a Hutterite quote written 350 years ago, which compares the religious community to a single organism into a beehive. Almost exactly a year ago, I went to the St. John's University in Minnesota, which is also the oldest Benedictine monastery in the United States. And I was asked to give a lecture, a televised lecture, and also to participate in a conversation with the faculty and some of the monks there, which was a wonderful experience. And so I went there, And they have a big church on campus, which was built in the 1930s, very bold architecturally for its time. And what do I see in this wonderful, wonderful stained glass window, but the beehive motif, the honeycomb motif. This idea of a religious group as like an organism and as a beehive was very, very common. And so what we want to do is now, can we treat this as a legitimate scientific hypothesis? Now, here is a taxonomy of major evolutionary hypotheses, which evolutionists apply to all traits. So if I were studying spots on guppies, I would be employing these same major hypotheses that can be used to examine religion. So the first question an evolutionist wants to know when they study something is this thing an adaptation? Is this a product of natural selection? Or is it one of many, many non-adaptive byproducts of natural selection, as my Terry predecessor, Stephen Jay Gould, never tired of pointing out? It was probably his dying words, rest in peace. Not everything is adaptive. If something counts as an adaptation, then there's a number of ways that it could have evolved. It could be a group-level adaptation that evolves because it benefits groups compared to other groups. And so in the context of religion, as we can examine religions, and we can say, do the elements of religion actually increase the survival and reproduction, the hard biological survival and reproduction of the entire group of religious believers compared to other groups? Or it might be an individual level adaptation. It might benefit some individuals at the expense of other individuals. And so we might study religions, and we might decide that appearances to the contrary, they're a form of exploitation, and that the leaders are fleecing their flock. They're not leading their flock, so that we could explain this in terms of individual self-interest. With culture, we have a third possibility, because culture has this way of passing from head to head. It can be like a disease organism. And so it's theoretically possible that you can get units of culture which actually are infective, and they're good for themselves. They perpetuate themselves, but they're not good for either individuals or groups. And so we could conceivably study religions, and we could decide that they're like the AIDS virus. They sweep through the population, and they make everyone worse off. You laugh, but it's a possibility. Now, if religion is not an adaptation, there's a number of ways that this can be explained. It's possible that the traits that we associate with religion were adaptive in the Stone Age, when the groups were much smaller and more related to each other. And so you might find that the traits associated with religion made perfect sense in small groups of related individuals, but they don't make good sense in large groups of unrelated individuals. Another good example of this is our eating habits. So if you look at our appetites for fats and sugars and so on, they're bad for us today. They make us fat and obese. But if you just go back to the Stone Age, you see they made great sense because we evolved in an environment of food shortage, not in food surplus. And so we could study religion hard, and we could discover that religion is like obesity. It's good for us back then, but bad for us today. Or we might decide, or another way that religion could be non-adaptive is if the traits that we associate with religion are connected to other traits that are obviously advantageous. And so they're costly in a religious context, but the very same traits are adaptive in a non-religious context. And it turns out that the prevailing theory of religion in the social sciences, due to Rodney Stark, is actually such a byproduct theory. This is a theory that Stark takes an economic approach to religion, and his idea is that humans are really good sort of homo economicus, cost-benefit utility maximizers. We're really good at figuring stuff out and making explanations and maximizing our benefits in a non-religious context. So we get all kinds of stuff this way. No problem explaining the evolution of this way of thinking. Unfortunately, even after we get everything that we can get this way, there's other things remaining that we can't have, such as rain during a drought or everlasting life. We want them, and we have no way of getting them. But that does not prevent us from trying, making explanations, and trying to get them. And so according to Stark, what religion is the economic mind spinning its wheels to get what we can't have. We invent gods with whom to bargain for that which we can't have. And so if you were to study religion hard, what you discover is that religious belief, it doesn't make anyone better. It's costly by itself, but we just can't get rid of it because it's connected to this other way of thought. And you see the benefit over here in non-religious context. So I really want to stress that we're not making up straw men here. All of these theories are plausible, have been proposed throughout the history of the study of religion, regardless of whether anyone used the E word. All of these theories are plausible and have been proposed. Furthermore, they are so different from each other that it should be possible for theories which make such different predictions to pit them against each other empirically. Surely a religion which is designed for the good of the group must be different than a theory that's designed as a tool of exploitation, which must be different than something that's its own organism that simply parasitizes humans, which must be different than something which was good for small groups and bad for big groups, which must be different than something which is bad in a religious context but clearly connected to something which is good in a non-religious context. If science can make progress on anything, then surely it should be able to discriminate among hypotheses as different as these. So how do we go about testing these hypotheses? If you look at the information on religion, you'll see it exists in two forms. There is a social scientific literature on religion, which is pretty big, and of course quantitative, as all good scientists are. And then there's a huge body of traditional religious scholarship. I didn't know how big until I started to try to study this for myself, and it was like staring up at Mount Everest. So no one, I say in my book, who has confronted this literature can claim to have mastered it. And it's very important not to pass over this descriptive information on our way to studying religion scientifically. Something that I like to point out is that Darwin established his theory entirely on the basis of careful descriptive information, what we call natural history information, about plants and animals, gathered primarily by people who thought they were studying God's handiwork. And so descriptive information is good enough. It was good enough for Darwin. And of course, it can always be refined quantitatively, but we have the potential of, evolutionary inquiry begins with a detailed descriptive understanding of organisms in relation to their environment. And so if we want to get started with studying religion from an evolutionary perspective, we need detailed descriptive studies, information on religious groups in relation to their environment. And so in my own inquiry, I started in this way by picking some of the best studied examples that I could think of to look at what we can call the natural history of religion. As we heard at the beginning, I have a chapter on Calvinism, wonderful work by the anthropologist Steve Lansing on the water temple system of Bali. Certainly for a Westerner, one of the most exotic religions that you could possibly imagine. There's the, their big temple on the top of the mountain with the virgins and the high priest, and then there's temples all the way down the mountain. So there's elaborate things that we associate with religion, and it turns out to have the eminently practical function of regulating and orchestrating the production of rice and managing a trade-off between irrigation, water distribution, and pest control. And so this wonderfully pragmatic aspect of this religion is there side by side with this wonderfully otherworldly aspect. I talk a bit about Judaism as a broad religious tradition, and then, as you mentioned, some work on early Christianity. Now, the beauty is in the details, and I tried to provide some of these details in my book. In this talk, I can only touch upon them, so the impact will be not as strong. But in each case, I try to examine the what we could call the anatomy of religion by breaking it into three different components. One we could call the people-people relationship. What does religion explicitly tell its members to do? And of course, religions are full of explicit behavioral prescriptions, thou shalt and shalt nots at all levels of generalities, from from very general to very specific. So how can we evaluate these explicit behavioral prescriptions? Then there's the God-people relationship, the more theological aspect of the of a given religion. What is the nature of God or gods and their relationship with people? And can we interpret this as a set of beliefs which strongly motivate the behaviors that are prescribed in the people-people relationship? And finally, what is the social organization of a religion like? And to what extent could it be interpreted as two things? First of all, a set of coordination mechanisms, because for any group to function as an adaptive unit, obviously its people must do something, the right things at the right time. And so there must be a set of instructions, basically, for how to behave. And then, of course, there's the all-important problem of cheating. And here's a quote from Martin Bucer, a contemporary of Calvin, who said, "Where there is no discipline in excommunication, there is no Christian community. If we cannot punish and exclude the cheater, basically we cannot have a cooperative society." And what I conclude on the basis of these case studies is what Durkheim called the secular utility of religion, that these religions function so well in purely pragmatic terms as engines of collective action, basically, to cause people to cooperate as a unit. Here's just a few examples. This is from a Calvin scholar talking about Calvin's Geneva. And I chose this example because it's a great natural experiment. Evolutionists are always on the lookout for natural experiments in which the environment changes, something before and after. You actually didn't do the manipulation yourself, but it was something close to an experiment that took place all by itself. And in the case of Calvinism, we have this great example during the Reformation where Geneva had kicked out the Catholics. They were trying to function as a political entity. They had a very strong secular government and a democratic secular government, and yet they were just not functioning well. They could not pull together. And why was that? Because so many factionalism was called the Genevan disease. It needed to pull together, but it couldn't. And then the strong religion came in, and McGrath says, "Events in the absence of Farel and Calvin had demonstrated the close interdependence of reformation and autonomy, of morals and morale. Although the city council was concerned primarily with the independence and morale of the city, the fact that Farel's religious agenda could not be evaded gradually dawned. The pro-Farel party probably had little enthusiasm for religious reformation or the enforcement of public morals. Nevertheless, it seemed that the survival of the Genevan Republic hinged upon them." And I love this juxtaposition of these two words, morals and morale, etymologically similar also, of course. So what it seems, morals, of course, is a sense of right and wrong, a strong sense of right and wrong. And morale is a strong motivation for action. And what this seems to be implying is that you need a strong moral system in order to have a strong sense of morale, in order to pull together as a community. This is the work of Elaine Pagels that that you referred to. And basically, well, what it says is the author of Mark then offers a rudimentary model for Christian community life. The Gospels that the majority of Christians adopted in common all followed, at some extent, Mark's example. Successive generations found in the New Testament Gospels what they did not find in many other elements of the early Jesus tradition, a practical design of Christian communities. Pagel's thesis is that if you look at the difference between the four Gospels of the New Testament and the other Gospels, which didn't make it into the New Testament, and you ask, why are they so different? The reason is not because of the passage of time or because memory fades with time. It's because each of these Gospels was serving a different local Christian congregation, which stood in a different relationship with its social environment. And so what happened was is that the sacred story was altered in each of these cases in order to provide a suitable blueprint for the particular social environment. And so the reason that Jesus was well received in his hometown in one version and almost run off a cliff in the other version is because that these congregations were a Jewish community and a Gentile community, respectively. And there's many, many other examples that she provides. And so what this does in evolutionary terms is this is an interpretation of these texts as like a fossil record of cultural adaptations, that these religious groups are adapting themselves to their local environment so quickly that we begin to pick up these differences on a timescale of decades. Here is John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, who says, "I do not see how it is possible in the nature of things for any revival of true religion to continue for long, for religion must necessarily produce both industry and frugality, and these cannot but produce riches. But as riches increase, so will pride, anger, and love of the world and all of its branches." And what Wesley here is discerning is something that religious scholars have documented all around the world, a kind of a life cycle of religions, in which what happens is a group of people get together and they need to cooperate, so they form a strong religion, and it makes them wealthy. It's the proof of religion as providing secular benefits. Once they become wealthy, then they no longer have the incentive to cooperate, and they want to do business outside of the religious group, and so the religion becomes weak. And another thing that happens is that, although I'm focusing on group selection, there's lots of exploitation that does take place within religions, and so you do get the creation of haves and have-nots. And so those who are not being benefited by their religion go off and they form a new religion, a sect, which they regard as the pure form of the religion, and the life cycle continues again. We see this taking place. It takes place, if you look at the big churches on the green here, and you ask, what was Congregationalism like, the Puritan religions like back then, and what are they like now? And what have they been replaced with in terms of strong, vigorous religions? And you can see this life cycle taking place before our very eyes. Okay, so the secular utility of religion just jumps out, at least from these particular case studies. And often when I talk about this, many people say, okay, that's great, you know, religious people cooperate, but that doesn't explain the essence of religion. The essence of religion is a psychological experience. And furthermore, how do we explain the otherworldliness of religion? That's what makes it so fascinating to the secular mind, and especially to the scientist, to the academic mind, is why does it have to be so irrational, basically? Why does it have to flaunt the kind of thought that we associate with economic and scientific thought? And when we think about this, it really helps to bring in the distinction between proximate and ultimate causation and evolutionary biology. So for example, plants bloom in spring because it would be bad for their survival and reproduction to bloom earlier or later. But the mechanistic reason that they bloom in spring is because they're sensitive to day length. Day length by itself doesn't influence survival and reproduction. The proximate mechanism that causes the plant to do what it does need bear no relationship to the adaptive function of blooming when it does. And so what this means is that when we look at all aspects of religious belief, no matter how apparently irrational or otherworldly, or no matter how much it's not directly motivated by communitarian purposes but for other motivations, all of these things need to be judged by one standard and one standard alone, which is, what do these things cause people to do? What does religious belief, however it appears, cause people to do? And once again, this is not a straw man that we're creating. It's perfectly possible that religious belief can cause people to do things which are not good for their own secular utility or anyone else's. Maybe it causes them to go and become a hermit in the mountains. So no way is it obvious that religious belief causes the religious believer to participate in cooperative activities. This is an empirical question. But when you look at the empirical information, more often than not, you find a very tight relationship between serving God and serving co-religionists. That's represented here by the definition, one definition of Islam, which says, a noun derived from the verb aslama, designates the act by which an individual recognizes his or her relationship to the divine, and at the same time, the community of all those who respond in submission. It describes, therefore, both the singular vertical relationship between the human being and God and the collective horizontal relationship of all those who join together in common faith and practice. And so again and again, perhaps it was already obvious to you, but again and again, you see this linkage between the spiritual aspects of religion and the otherworldly aspects of religion and the pragmatic aspects that we've already described. Okay, well, these are wonderful examples, but a skeptic will immediately criticize them for the problem of selection bias. Who's to say that I didn't pick and choose my examples and that somebody else could choose other examples to support their particular theory? So selection bias is a problem, and it's a problem with a solution. And the solution is called a random sampling. So in order to solve this problem, I need to choose a sample of religions and without any reference to any particular hypothesis. And so being a good scientist, I did this. There is an Encyclopedia of Religion by Elliott, 16 volumes, and I wrote a little computer program which selected volume numbers at random, and then for each volume, it chose a page number at random, and that dropped me into the encyclopedia. And I had a procedure for paging forward until I found the first entry that qualified as a religious system. And in this fashion, I chose 36 religions, utterly at random, which I then studied with respect to these hypotheses. This survey was initiated in my book, and then I have continued it. And I have a paper on it for anyone who is interested. Here is a list of the religions that were included. Some you might have heard of, others you might not have. I certainly hadn't. It includes all the major traditions, including some indigenous religions, such as African religions. And this was a wonderful experience because it really forced me to study religions that I never would have encountered otherwise, including some which, superficially at least, appear extremely challenging to the hypothesis of religious groups as being agents of cooperation. And by far the most challenging religion in the sample is this one, Jainism. Jainism is as old as Buddhism, about 3,000 years old. It's practiced by a very small fraction of the Indian community, about 3%. But of course, it has tremendous stability. One of the world's most ascetic religions. The Jains are the ones who strain the water that they drink and the air that they breathe. They carry a broom that they sweep in front of them so that they don't kill any tiny creature. The renunciates give away all their possessions, and in some cases, one of the highest ideals is to fast themselves to death, as this fellow is doing right here. And so how can something like this be explained from an evolutionary perspective? Wouldn't this be a case of religion being bad for you in any sort of materialistic terms? So I was forced to study this religion and therefore thrilled to encounter this book, whose title says it all, Riches and Renunciation, Religion, Economy, and Society Among the Jains. And what Laidlaw shows, and this is, known among Jain scholars, so it's not as if this is remarkable, at least, amongst a community of people, is that the ascetic Jains, the renunciates, are a very small fraction of the total Jain religion, whose lay members include some of the wealthiest merchants of India. And ecologically, the Jains function very similarly to Judaism in Western Europe. It's a diaspora community. It's a trading society. Many of the Jains are gem traders, and their problem is that they have to do business and cooperate over long distances. They have to make deals very fast, and their religion solves the problem of trust in a way that other people just can't solve. This very, very strong religion basically establishes cooperation in an economy in which it's very important to do so. And I have to tell you just one detail. I'm sorry to go on just a little bit long, but this is the kind of excitement that I had consulting this descriptive literature on religion. So the Jain renunciates, they're homeless, and they beg for food, but their food restrictions are so great that they could only accept food from Jains, from the late Jains. And in fact, their food restrictions are so pure that what happens when they go to a house, they go in and they inspect it to make sure that it's pure enough for them to accept food. And from the standpoint of a lay Jain family, if you see these renunciates come to your house, it's a matter of great fear, because if they come and they leave without food, then this is a demonstration that you are not pure enough for them. And it's a disgrace, a very public disgrace. If they leave with food, then this is a mark that you are a pious member of the community. And so who would have known in the absence of detailed ethnographic, basically, information that the renunciates are in essence acting as a kind of a police force a moral police force, doing a kind of a policing similar to what we see in honeybees. So the conclusions from the random sample are this. Most religions in the sample have what Durkheim called secular utility. The practical benefits are inherently group and other-oriented. Morality is all about benefiting others in society, almost axiomatically. And religions are all about, in their design, not that they always succeed, but in their design, they're all about benefiting the group and others. In many cases, these religions were so practical that they just seemed indistinguishable from a political organization. And I find myself wondering, why were these included in this encyclopedia? But it's not me who included them. So the selection criteria for the encyclopedia, that was done from someone else. But that's how practical so many of these religions were. And so what this means is that if we return to our major evolutionary hypotheses, evolution is a messy process. There's some scope for all of these possibilities. I'm certainly not saying that every detail of religion is adaptive or adaptive at the group level. But if you're not centering your conception of religion first on adaptation, which recognizes that these are producing secular benefits, and secondly on group level adaptations, then you are missing the center of religion. And I believe that we can say that purely even on the basis of natural history information, and of course refining this information quantitatively will be welcome. In other cases, the secular utility of religion is obscured by the otherworldly features that make religion such a puzzle to study. Many of these religions, of course, are not superficially do not appear all that pragmatic. But when you look at the nature of these religious beliefs, most often we can reconcile this paradox with the proximate ultimate distinction that when you judge these beliefs by what they cause the religious believer to do, then this paradox and this distinction can be resolved. Here's a point which I haven't made yet, but it's a great point. Since I have a random sample, I can ask a question like this. How many religions in the sample spread by violent conquest? People are always accusing religions of being prone to violent between-group interactions. And I can report that although, of course, the sample did include some of these, the majority of religions spread by nonviolent means. So differences in the fitness of groups can take place in many ways. And in most cases with religion, it was nonviolent. I found that to be very interesting. And so there's the beauty of random sampling. Barring a freak sampling accident, all valid conclusions from the sample apply to the entire population of religions from which the sample was taken. So what I'm able to show for my sample of 36 religions applies to every religion in the encyclopedia, barring freak sampling accidents. Well, this is my last slide here. This is one of my favorite quotes from Darwin. He's a young man, and he's on a field trip with his professor, Adam Sedgwick. They're looking for fossils, but that was dumb because this valley in Wales was scoured by glaciers. But the theory of glaciation had not yet been proposed. And so he says, "We spent many hours in Cumead Wall examining all the rocks with extreme care, as Sedgwick was anxious to find fossils in them. But neither of us saw a trace of the wonderful glacial phenomena all around us. We did not notice the plainly scored rocks, the perched boulders, the lateral and terminal moraines. Yet these phenomena are so conspicuous that a house burnt down by fire did not tell its story more plainly than did this valley. If it had still been filled by a glacier, the phenomena would have been less distinct than they are now." And the reason that I love this quote is that it illustrates the need for a theory to see what is in front of our faces. And in the absence of a theory, what Darwin saw was just a jumble that he couldn't interpret. With the appropriate theory, what he saw was so clear that it just became self-evident. And I can't help but think that despite the long, long history of thinking on human sociality in general and religions in particular, that we're faced with a similar situation, that when we have the right set of ideas, these things are going to be that obvious in retrospect. So thank you. Sir, you need to come down to the microphone. And it would be efficient if you have questions, and please don't be shy, just to come down and stand in line so that we can be efficient.
As I listened to you as a biologist, I found myself more in agreement than I expected to be. But I still find confusing from what you said today about group selection. It seems to me there is clearly a domain of selection, of cultural selection, which has nothing to do with genes, and there's clearly a domain of individual selection, which has a lot to do with genes. But when you talk about human groups and apply the term group selection, then I find that the argument becomes very difficult to follow. What we know about human evolution and certainly human behavior in recorded history is that there's been a lot of intergroup conflict and, in fact, probably even an evolved sense of a tendency to be suspicious of strangers and so forth. But what we also know, I think we know fairly clearly, is that the human species has relatively little genetic heterogeneity in it, and in fact, very little of any consequence that separates groups, particularly in terms of cognitive capacities and intellectual abilities. So, and what we also know about warfare, both primitive warfare and I think modern warfare, is that success, it would be very difficult to make an argument that success depends on genetic differences between the groups and depends instead on a variety of cultural phenomena, leadership, size, etc. And in fact, even the great disparity in human cultural advancement, if we can call what has happened in the last 200 years in advance, seems to depend very little on genetic differences between humans. So I would, although I'm not going to try to do it, I would try right now, I would argue that everything that you have described is equally well explained at the level of individual selection, and that you're stretching things a bit to in the domain of group selection.
Who do I have the honor of speaking with?
Tim Goldsmith. And in fact, I used to teach before I recently retired. I used to teach a course not too dissimilar to the one that you described in detail in the first lecture.
Well, thank you. First, let me say that tomorrow I will be giving a more technical talk to the biology department on this subject. People want to delve a little bit more into the details. But a short answer, and I agree with much that you say, and let me try to play it back to you, okay? It's true, and the kids here will certainly affirm it, is that if you look at human groups purely from a genetic standpoint, it does not seem very favorable for group selection in the sense that most of the genetic variation exists within groups, and not much variation exists between groups. And that's true for both small groups and large. So that's point one, with which I agree with you. Point two is that if you look at human groups from the phenotypic standpoint, in terms of how they actually behave, then that's much more favorable for group selection in the sense that you see a lot of phenotypic uniformity within groups and a lot of differences between groups. So we find huge differences, a population structure that's very favorable for group selection at the phenotypic level, but not at the genetic level. So how does this happen? Well, this happens because of the traits associated with moral systems that I already discussed. It's because we're constituted the way we are in terms of our moral sentiments that include something called altruistic punishment, which has been in the journals lately. But the way we are is such is that we decide upon the appropriate way to behave. Some of us do it out of goodwill, and the others of us are forced to do it by punishment. And so this creates huge differences between groups and suppresses differences within groups, especially of the sort that we associate with cheating. Now, what this means is that at the cultural level, a lot of the fitness differentials that are taking place is at the level of between groups. But there's also a genetic story that needs to be told. We have to ask that these traits that we associate with such things as moral righteousness and conformity, imitation, all of these things which are having these effects at the phenotypic level, there is an innate component to them. So there has to be a genetic story that's told about them. When you tell that means that there had to be genetic variation, and that genetic variation had to be partitioned into within-group components and between-group components. And although we're not going to get through it here, my claim is that the genetic evolution of these traits that are responsible for the cultural evolution that I think we can agree upon, those in many cases also evolved by between-group selection. In other words, the groups that had even one or a few what we call altruistic punishers. This is think of John Wayne in your group. Okay? He's a really nice guy, and he kills you if you don't also behave. Okay, think of a group organized by John Wayne compared to a group that's not organized by John Wayne. Now, John Wayne doesn't do better than the other individuals in his group. In fact, if you look at John Wayne movies, like The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance, it's the other guy that gets the girl. And so being a police and doing this kind of solid citizen type stuff, including enforcing solid citizen behavior in others, it's hard work. And so when you compare differences within groups, you see the typical social dilemma problem. And it's going to require a between-group differential, that group doing better than other groups, both at the cultural level and at the genetic level. So you put your finger on something very important. And I just want to say that there's a sizable literature which is discussing exactly this. So I think the most important thing to say is that this is the kind of issue which is in the process of being discussed. And so you brought us right to the forefront, basically, in terms of the theoretical issues that are being discussed.
Yeah, though I'm a sociologist, I would like to know, what is a group? I'm asking this question, to give it a frame. I think the notion of group selection, as you introduced it, was reference to former social philosophies like Rousseau or Spencer or some. It was very attractive in the 19th century because you had nation states with clear boundaries that looked like organisms. You could almost perceive a skin. So if you cross a boundary, there was another organism. But I mean, I'm not sure if the metaphor here really fits. And the notion of group was continued, of course, in economics, where you had corporations, so clearly identifiable firms. And some economists still work with an evolutionary framework, but at least in the field of sociology, it's not really clear what these groups are supposed to be. If we have formal organizations, it's clear, so we are members of Yale University or something like this. But in other cases, it's more kind of diffuse. I'm not even sure if we should talk about different cultures in terms of groups today, because even with reference to religions, I mean, there are so many kind of self-taught religions. Isn't it coming from California? It's just you pick this and that, and so there are no groups where you can expel someone. And I would even, just as a further comment, with reference to Hierarchy in the Forest, this book you mentioned, some anthropologists who argue his arguments are Berm's arguments are mistaken because these small hunter and gatherer communities are in fact not moralistic communities because you have an easy exit option. So if there's conflict, you're not engaged in you're not the moral troublemaker, but you just go away. And if that's the case, I mean, this is an empirical question, then again, you wouldn't have groups in the sense of the islands or the high-stake models you introduced in your first lectures. So I'm kind of skeptical. What are these groups supposed to be?
Another great question. And I coined a term in 1975 called trait group, And what that term does is it recognizes something which I think has always been implicit in the concept of groups, which is most easily recognized when you just see how the concept is used in an everyday setting. So when we talk about groups, it's almost invariably in reference to particular activities. So I have a bowling group, I have a study group, I have a university, I might have a religious faith, I might have a congregation, I have a nation. All of these are groups which are defined in relation to particular activities. And when you see how groups are used in biology, you see just the same thing, is that if we study warning cries, which is a typical altruistic behavior, it's implicit that we're talking about the group that's influenced by a warning cry. It might be a bird flock. And when we talk about resource conservation, as when Edwards did, and so the idea here is that you have some individuals that are prudent and they don't overexploit their resources, and others which are imprudent and do. Implicit in that definition is that this has to be the set of individuals which are sharing the same resources. And so the group is defined in terms of the activity. And I think that that definition of groups is very nice for two reasons. First of all, it's very flexible in general across traits. It has a huge flexibility. But it's very inflexible with respect to a particular trait. That once you're talking about a given trait, which has an effect, and it affects a set of individuals, then that defines the group. So humans in particular participate in many, many groupings. But when they do something, think of what they do as a kind of a snapshot, okay, in terms of its fitness effects, which defines the group. And if you were to calculate the fitness consequences of that action, and if it's a typical kind of solid citizen or cooperative or an altruistic trait, what you'll find is that just inherently the nature of these traits is that it's providing a public benefit. There's a benefit which is shared, and there's a private cost, okay? And so that defines the group, and it defines the local disadvantage. Natural selection is operating against that trait at that scale. And unless there's a population structure above that scale causing that collective to do better than other collectives in which that didn't take place, this will not evolve. And so this is a very flexible notion of groups, but it needs to be flexible. And if you see how groups are used in other academic settings, you'll also find that flexibility. So it's a kind of flexibility that needs to be there. And I think it's very consistent with the theory. It ends up being a strength. And to give an example from the water temple system of Bali, one of the special things about it is that there's a temple at each node of the irrigation system. And each one defines a downstream congregation because of the situation here is like this big nested hierarchy of groups. And there are certain decisions which are going to involve a subgroup. And for every one of these, there is a separate religion, basically. And then as you go beyond that, then there's other temples. One reason that we might study polytheism is that instead of having a master deity which organizes all aspects of life, we can have separate deities for different aspects of life. That's a testable hypothesis. But if so, then what we'd be talking about, we'd be acknowledging the existence of multiple groups and often very flexible groups, but it would not be damaging to the theory. And this, let me give you one other example of this idea of leaving some of the current models. I'm very anxious to acquaint you with the literature that's taking place right now. It involves a game theory strategy called walkaway. And basically, this is a cooperative strategy which, when it meets someone, it cooperates. But if there's defectors in the group above a certain threshold, rather than retaliating, which is another strategy, that's the punisher, this is the walkaway. It leaves. Okay? So what that does is it doesn't eliminate the concept of group. It simply changes the population structure. On the basis of this behavior, we have new groupings. And within every one of these, so these groups are dissolving, they're fissioning, but what's constant in all of these is that within every set of individuals that are interacting with each other, the advantage goes to the cheater. That local disadvantage exists, and it has to be counterbalanced by some between group process. And the strategies which cause individuals to leave, form groups, and so on, that's part of the process. But it's a part that can be understood in terms of multi-level selection. It does not interfere, basically, or weaken the theory. I think, actually, quite the opposite. Sorry for such a long-winded answer.
Wilson, you've taken on one heresy in evolutionary theory, group selection. I saw a hint of another one, and that's Lamarckism, in one of your potential or future Terry lecturers, the person who's dealing with symbolic transmission, which I think Ed Wilson and Charles Lumsden, following Dobzhansky, referred to this sort of cultural transmission of memes as Lamarckian in its principles. And that seems to me to be also to involve the temporal scale, a good deal more rapid form of transition. So I wonder if you could comment on a kind of Lamarck redux here as well.
Well, all heresies need to be examined, and Lamarckism is not very heretical when it comes to cultural evolution. There's many, with respect to genetic evolution, there's serious questions as to how a Lamarckian mechanism would work. If one were to be found that does work, then Lamarckian evolution in a broad scale produces much the same as Darwinian evolution. There are some scenarios in terms of hypermutable sites and stuff like that, in which actually a long period of evolution, of Darwinian evolution, can evolve mechanisms which do appear to be anticipatory. They're not truly anticipatory because there's been a long, long period of evolution which has caused these to be triggered at the right time, but they're sort of pseudo-Lamarckian. And many cultural mechanisms, and Don Campbell was very fond of using the phrase blind variation and selective retention. Everything is ultimately a process of blind, there's a blindness to anything that's creative at the bottom. But still, if you look at what we typically regard as intentional thought in humans, and clearly it's guided in a sense, and no one would want to deny that. And it would be foolish to call it heretical just because it has some relationship with Lamarckism. So I think that at the end of the day, we need to incorporate sort of common sense, what we already know clearly exists in terms of human capacities, but also not to give it too much, attribute too much to it. And in my island hopping, I've come across branches of the social sciences in which so much was attributed to intentional thought, as if everything that's functional in human life was deliberately designed. And that's way overshooting. I think one of the most interesting implications of this is that much of the wisdom that exists in cultures nobody planned it. And that at some sense, life consists of many social experiments, a few that succeed. And that when a society works, we don't know how it works. We don't always have the slightest glimmer. And so we need to discover, as scientists, why it works. And so I think one of the hardest things is to give some scope for so many different things. Intentional thought, rational thought is one. Open-ended learning is another. Imitation is another. And then just many social experiments, a few that succeed, as something which is still going on very actively.
I sat here listening to your lecture, and I couldn't help but be overtaken by one thing that was running through my mind, the paradoxes of all of this. And I really beg you, implore you, that you not be so dogmatic about, or at least your colleagues in the sociology, sociobiological arena, to be so dogmatic about some of the theories that you support. I will give you one example. In one of your first slides, where you kind of try to make a progress, shall we say, from unicellular organisms to multicellular organisms, to tissues and whole organs and to individuals, and then you go directly into the individual to the society and groups. And that looks good on paper. The problem is that you, in fact, alluded to one of your very first sentences is that there's a power of biology in bonds in the physical universe that has to be reckoned with. That's how DNA, that's how all genetic mechanisms work. But sociology, which is the other great force, the other great living force here on this planet, is really made up of a vague communication between individuals. And we tend to look at other examples, as Darwin did, of life on this planet to kind of put into perspective what we were destined, so to speak, to become. And I think that is basically the gist of what I'm trying to say. There's a dogma to all of this. There has to be an open-mindedness to it.
Let me just intrude and have you go on. But I meant nothing progressive by anything that I said. There's been progressive views of evolution all along, but no way I'm saying is that multicellular organisms are better or more advanced. None of that. So please don't confuse anything I said with progressivism. Now I'm interested to know what else I've confused.
No. What I'm saying is that you seem to link these as though they were linkable. That the physics behind the biology of an organism can now go forth, and that the same physics can explain sociological behavior. There's now this gray zone that we've now entered. Neurobiologists and neuropsychobiologists are trying to figure out what makes not only human behavior tick, but all of animal behavior tick. So, in other words, go from the physics, the covalent bonds, the ionic bonds, into the actual observation of these sociological units. Okay, the point I'm trying to make is that to be open-minded about this, because in my own life, in my own experience, there are these proteias, revelations that I've made on my behalf of beliefs that I had a long time ago that now have just come full circle. And I'll give you this is an example, it's a humorous example, at least I think it is. Many people here are familiar with the very famous Kennedy inaugural speech where he says, ask not what your country can do, et cetera, et cetera. But I was more enamored with the last line of that whole speech. If you remember, that paragraph really goes, he's trying to assemble the entire, humanity, mankind, to come forth and be a unified force, okay? And he says, he implores God, he asks God's help, and then he says, let us go forth, and for God's work must truly be our own. And for the longest time, I said, that's so romantic. And I think everybody in this room would say, what he's asking is, like God's help. Okay. And then several years ago, I ran across a kind of a humorous quip where a guy, is one of these, guys goes up to the mountain to the guru and asks, he finally gets an audience with God. And he's, God, I've been searching the world I've got to justify my own existence, and it's so beautiful out there. Is it worth it? Is life worth it? Is my life, there's got to be an answer. There's got to be a meaning to my life. And God says, shrugs his shoulder and says, well, if you say so. And that's the whole point. It changed my perspective of that initial John F. Kennedy speech to now I'm saying, well, is it possible for us to be, to have fate in our own hands? It's more of an interpretive type of process that we need to go through, and again, be very open-minded and not so dogmatic about, and be clear about the processes, point A to point B to point C, that we go through.
Well, if you wanted to wound me, you succeeded by saying I'm a close-minded fellow. That makes me so sad. I would like to continue this conversation at the reception, and let me just make one point of clarification, which brings us once again back to the proximate ultimate distinction. One of the great intellectual resources of evolutionary biology is to be able to make so much progress on the basis of ultimate causation without any reference to the physics or the chemistry or even the genes. So when we talk about something like humans explaining human sociality from a multi-level perspective, something is going on in terms of evolutionary processes which is comparable to beehives and single organisms, but not at all comparable in terms of any of the proximate mechanisms. And so I think that there's a sense in which I just want to make that distinction because I think that we want to do is just walk across the parking lot and we'll continue.